talking about Senator Ping Lacson, let's talk about his performance last night. I read some views. He wasn't as strong as he was in other interviews and forums. I want to get what sense you got. Dr. Tihanki, let's start with you first, and we'll go to Professor Edna for the next question. Go ahead.
Yes, because see, Senator Ping comes as, of course, the original Iron Fist, no? Before Duterte, no? But now compared to President Duterte, he has become a statesman, no? So, but then there's that very strong personality. I think some focus group discussions have already advised him to soften up on that image, no? So perhaps, no? Perhaps, no? So it's a way of being relatable, no? In, I think in one of the forums, somebody asked him why he's not smiling, no? So I think this is part of the course correction in his campaign to make him more relatable.
Professor Edna, I want to talk to you about Kalyodi last night and his performance, and really not wavering. He's been so consistent from day one. But the thing is that something that is really resonating with the voters who at the end of the day will cast their votes either for him or for someone else. Has he been gaining support? What do you think?
I think basically Kalyodi shows his ideology, and again, that's something to respect in his case. I think he sticks to his position on who should be at the center of governance and what it should stand for. But can I put it this way? But the job that you're applying, the shirt that you are supposed to wear, will probably not match or not fit if you look only at one sector or one side. And that may be a challenge, no, for some people, and that could reduce the convincing power of what he sells in terms of his idea and the ideology, because the shirt that we are filling in is someone who can resort to new modalities of doing things beyond just focus on the working class and the workers. It requires bringing in the private sector. It requires a shirt that will challenge the small, medium, and the relatively well-off industries. And if you're too focused on one particular sector, then it raises the doubts from the other sectors, which would probably tend to ask, but how do we come into your frame, into your framework? And therefore, it somehow affects an identification with that kind of marketing of ideas. I mean, yeah. I'm not saying that that should not be done. I think he pushes hard on the value of giving importance to the working sector.
But doesn't that, doesn't that show the candidate's conviction, Dr. Tihanki? Right.
Well, I admire Kalyodi's candidacy. Why? Because, again, it's a first real socialist. And, you know, we've been hearing the usual neoliberal platitudes from the mainstream candidates. No, and here's a guy who's offering a radical alternative, wealth tax. I mean, who else speaks of wealth tax but Bernie Sanders in the United States and other socialists, right? So I think, but again, they're realistic. I mean, Kalyodi and Walden are realistic enough to from 0.75 to 1, that's already an achievement, no? I think their involvement here is really to slowly normalize ideological positions in national election. And I think that's very good for electoral maturity of this country, okay. No? And I think his idol is Lula of Brazil, no? Lula ran 3 times, no? Before he became president. Lula's a labor leader himself, no? Mm-hmm. Who knows, no? After 3 tries, no? He might become president.
Let's talk about Mayor Isko Moreno and then Vice President Lenny Robredo. Your thoughts on the performance of the two, Professor Edna, what do you think about how the mayor performed last night?
Well, I think it's if you put him in a scale, he's in the middle. I mean, he says his piece. But I thought, given the questions that were raised to him, he would tend to please everyone as much as he can. And there, by doing that, he loses the big flavor that can be identified with him, who is really who is really Isko Moreno, what he stands for, because he, sometimes he's sometimes neither here nor there, but he can accommodate everyone and many things despite what he calls the 10-point agenda or program that he was referring to.
Some have called him the most unifying candidate, but is he also the most compromising one?
I think that's the better word. If you will ask me, it's a compromising position. Nothing is foul, and thus anything can be, can be redeemed. So you really have a range of people here in the presidential debate, from the very quiet, but now it's very nice that there is a forum like that you haven't heard from. But also there are some bright statements which have not been pursued, like former Executive Secretary Abella, who said, you know, the way forward is to mobilize science, technology, research and development, which exactly is in the medium term, the solution to economy, the solution to your pandemic. It is there, but no one except himself has told it. And no one had
been. And there was also only one candidate who addressed the climate crisis and the climate emergency that we're currently in. And it was only Kalyodi. And we do know, we all know that this is going to affect a lot of the policies in the future. I mean, Dr. Tihanki, you were talking about, you know, future-proofing the Philippines. What better way to future-proof the country, you know, if we don't talk about climate change and the climate emergency? Let's talk about, go ahead.
That's because all of these candidates, the mainstream ones, are comfortable, no, are speaking within their comfort zone, no, their sphere of expertise and experience, no, and some of them have grappled with issues that are quite beyond their comfort zone. Like for Mayor Isko, he did well with his Action Man proof of concept in Manila, but he grappled with international relations and geopolitics, no, particularly on the issue of Ukraine and Russia.
Carmina, in fairness to all the candidates, we probably are assessing them beyond what they have been told to respond to, and it's a matter of how questions were structured, and therefore they cannot go outside of those questions at that particular moment. So I think were there questions that could have been brought in addition to the, and we notice vice presidential and presidential, the questions were 80% similar. But why did I say that? You spoke about COVID-19, the economic recovery, the healthcare. They're the same, and spent a whole big of time on that, rather than, you know, now we're looking at what about the working class? What about this? What is the role of us? And there was no chance because the structure has very limited, latitude, and you only have to be faithful and loyal to the procedures that were set out.
But when Kalyodi brought up the issue of the climate emergency, it wasn't an answer to a question. He was able to find a way to make it relevant to the discussion.
Because that's been a core of his advocacy from all the interviews and the fora he has attended. He has always mentioned, I think he's the only one mentioning climate change.
You know what I think about that? The campaign is a moment to drop the message and anything at all that will provide that space for a candidate who's a minority in many ways, like Kalyodi, is really admirable in the sense that I will find the platform and I will find the space to say my piece, which has not been heard. That's the biggest affirmative desire and goal that Kalyodi has, I think, in this whole activity. Even if it's not popular, even if so many people don't agree with it, and he probably has hint that he may not get the number of votes to get there, but yeah, I don't care. And that's really pretty and charming for someone who really has something to say and says it.
Yeah, but do you think he's gone beyond being pretty and charming now? That he's
no,
actually...
I think.
Go ahead.
He represents a movement. No, it's a movement. Yeah. Movement politics. It's a social movement. The working class, the unions, trying to enter mainstream electoral parliamentary struggle. And I think we should support that. Although definitely he will not make it this electoral cycle, but he has planted the seeds.
A while ago, Professor Tihanki, you were talking about, you know, how traditional politicians, or at least those who have been steeped into the process and the whole procedure of governance, have been so comfortable with what they want to say, with the structure that they want to present. Do you think Vice President Lenny Robredo last night was too comfortable? Or did she present herself to the public as someone who is going beyond that? Who is not a product of the Liberal Party, who's not a product of the system, but that she is her own person and she is her own contender in these in the elections.
Yeah. To be fair with Vice President Lenny, she won the vice presidency with the help of the Liberal Party machinery, but she performed as vice president with the weakened Liberal Party. And of course, that shows a lot of strength, no, in her, and she presented that. And if given a chance, I think she will be able to perform much more.
All right, Professor Edna, do you want anything to add to that about the vice president's performance last night?
I think she has moved leaps and bounds from, I mean, she's learning very fast. She's learning very well on how to do her craft in the campaign. But also, I think it's not just about the campaign. What she really stands for at this point in time, because of the many exposures and experiences that she has been through. So it's genuine. It's not just about the campaign. It's about growing into the politics, which is really characterized both by how could you be popular, but also how could you make sense to those who would need and who would matter most in society.
All right, final words from you guys, but I want it to be very short. Professor Edna, I want to go to you first. What do you think should the people expect now, moving forward? I mean, we only have about 2 months to go before the May 9 elections. Can be considered a long time for a voter, but it is actually a short time already for the candidates. What are your expectations in the coming weeks?
I think the previous forums or debates should teach us the way forward in terms of how the candidates could be expected to say more, not beyond what they have said, beyond the images that they project, but at the same time, you know, really allow people to get to know them better. Of course, the ground operation and the ground campaign is there, but at least in terms of forum, this is the leveler activity where you can really compare ideas, thinking, perspectives, and what does one want to go forward. So forums, this kind of discussions, face-to-face, head-to-head, voters have a chance to really compare. It's not the massive waving of hands, or it's not really about what one, of course, that's important, that's part of the campaigning, but this is where we people can really see the difference. I just hope that it can be done, I don't know, reaching out to the lower groups of our countrymen so that it's not done in English, which can be very selective in terms of its audience. How can we compare? How can we compare what they have in their heart and in their mind? Mm-hmm.
Okay. Dr. July, your thoughts?
Well, 2 months are like an eternity in Philippine politics. It ain't over until it's over. In 2016, 54.2% of the voters decided to finally to vote after February. No, so we still have a lot of time. And a significant 18% decided only on election day. Although the undecided is between 3 to 6, it's still an open. There's still a narrow pathway, no, to catching up. And I think in the next few weeks, it's going to be a competition between Vice President Lenny and Mayor Isko for the right to challenge BBM in the finals.
Very interesting. I'm going to talk to you in the next, after 2 weeks then. See if you were just prophetic right that moment. thank you so much for joining us today. Always a pleasure talking shop with you, Professors Edna Ko and July T. Hanke. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Casey.
Take care.
Thank you. Thank you, Permina. Thank you.
All right, we're going to take a